Okay, so what was you saying?
Oh, we were looking at the plaque because we're going to put it, have it mounted on the wall. And I was sitting here Googling all these people whose names are on it. Uh-huh. Turns out half of them were Tammany Hall, half of them were indicted, half of them were including one. The one that really got me the most is, where was his name? His name Samuel, Dr. Samuel Buckler, third deputy.
Uh-huh. Yeah, wait a minute. Samuel Buckler.
You know, like a lot, and then it's like, that's it.
Yeah, that's
it. It turns out that he was a rabbi. He was a Jewish chaplain at Sing Sing. He was also a lawyer who was disbarred. So it's like, but it was so funny. You know, you have this beautiful plaque when you read about these characters. So it's interesting.
Yeah. Carl Stebbing's always been about, well,
someone
just using the wheel. So.
Someone just took the side of the building when the building was demolished, and then my friend works for the fire department, and they had this in storage, and they didn't want it anymore. I said, I'll take it.
Yeah, because you know, what are you? You're the historical.
I run the historical society.
Okay, well, what's it? Should I put? Do you want to be seen?
It's just,
oh, no, sorry.
Oh, I did get my hair done tonight. And then we have this plaque from the Society of Professional Journalists, which talks about Nellie Bly and Charles Dickens, who did investigative reports on the island.
Oh, so Charles Dickens was here
in 1842. Uh-huh. And he described the building as having lounging, listless madhouse air. And he cut his visit short to go see places that were more pleasant. He didn't like the lunatic asylum.
Who's Nellie Bly?
Nellie Bly was a young reporter who came here in 1887 while trying to get a job with the New York World, which was owned by Joseph Pulitzer, and she feigned insanity and had herself admitted to the asylum. And she stayed 10 days and reported when she got out how horrible the situation was there and how corrupt it was.
Now that's interesting, because years later, about in the 60s, over in Staten Island,
Willowbrook. Yeah, it's the same,
they had the same situation.
Yeah, nothing changes. It goes around, comes around. It's like Rikers Island. We're going to close down. We closed down the penitentiary on this island in 1936 because it was outdated and corrupt. Mm. They moved it to Rikers Island. Mm. I mean, we're running out of islands to move our institutions to.
Wow, we'll call them institutions. That was interesting. My history here is kind of interesting because, like I said, my mother.
Your mother
was here at Goldwater Memorial Hospital, and she was in the Iron Lung. That's when I first knows about that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But also, strangely enough, my twin sisters, her daughters, were at Willowbrook when all that stuff was happening.
Oh, so they were part of that. Were they residents there? Or
yes, they were very much residents, yeah. And, so and they were of age. They were like in their late teens.
So what happened to them?
When that broke with Robert F. Kennedy, right, uh-huh. doing all that mm-hmm. stuff, and Geraldo Rivera, sure. and the reporter. Mm-hmm. The other woman that did the whole thing, they got out of it. They had to put them in upstate New York and whatever. One of them is still living upstate New York.
Uh-huh. Well, the sad thing is that, you know, it improves for the time being, and then you have to, Willowbrook is now the college in Staten Island, mm-hmm. college in Staten Island on the campus, but it's very hard. It's very sad. The social situations don't stay unless you're really forcing them. And when they released everyone from institutions, it sounded wonderful, but it didn't work.
The thing is, history repeats, cycle. And people don't read enough to hold on. Mm-hmm. So thank you so much. What's your name?
Judy Birdie.
Okay,
I
Judy,
thanks
so much.
Card.
Okay, sure.
Hold on.